Keeping up with a rapidly changing industry is the challenge facing the AEC community. The role technology plays is no different, and consistently serving the specialized needs of an entire industry is one of technology's biggest obstacles. Behind the scenes at the 2016 Bluebeam Extreme Conference, I invited technologists from Bluebeam, Procore, Fieldlens, and Trimble, along with a common customer, to discuss the challenges tech companies face while trying to collaborate without losing their competitive edge.
Thank you so much for sitting down here today. Really wanted to have you all sit here today so that we could have a conversation about interoperability. And recently had a sit-down conversation where I met with the founders of the AEC Hackathon. And in that conversation, I asked them a question about, you know, why was the AEC Hackathon created? As I listened to their response, my first thought was, as a technologist, I'm pretty sure there's a rebuttal. I'm pretty sure there's a response. And so I wanted to kind of start off today's conversation, maybe with just a view of that initial answer to that question so that we could all hear it.
The AEC Hackathon was started because of the miscommunication between tech people and then people from the built environment. How do you bring together these two people to where the industry is really defining the bullseye for the technologist? Not just a direction. I think it's over here. This is my pain point. Solve this problem.
AECX and AEC Hackathon would not exist if they were doing it right. This is the watershed mark that we're no longer just going to change our way to have to go to a university to figure out how to use a tool, right? We're talking about the real integration of process, technology, and the outputs. Whoever can figure that out, either on a job site, as an individual, or as a company, those are going to be the winners in this new world.
As you hear that definition as to why AEC Hackathon was created, what were some of your ideas, Doug?
In the second quote, I hear frustration, perhaps about around the learning curve with respect to some of the technology out there, and I share that frustration. However, the quote around the bullseye, there's not a bullseye. There's a lot of bullseyes. There's not like one universal truth out there. We need a lot of different solutions to a lot of different problems, and in fact, when we hear our customer's pain point, we don't go build that exact thing to solve that pain point. We try to figure out, hey, like, how can we align a bunch of pain points together so that we can efficiently build something that solves all of them, or at least as many of them as we can get?
I actually really liked the sentiment about trying to solve problems. That's the way we try to think about building product, is that there's really two ways you can fail. One is that you don't talk to your customers at all. You think you have the right answers, you think you can build the best solution, but without going out and understanding what you're solving for and what you're trying to achieve for your customers, that's going to be a failure. The other way you can fail is if you become an order taker as a company and you only listen to this exact feature that they want, or hey, can you mimic this process digitally for us? And those often become pretty bad products as well. And I think the answer really is actually what he said is, we have a problem, this is the bullseye, and as you mentioned, there's many bullseyes, right? And we're trying to find them all and prioritize them as best we can, but at the end of the day, it's really about solving the problem, and that's our responsibility as software vendors, is to go out, talk to as many customers as we can, truly understand their problems, aggregate those together, and then try to do our best to solve them.
There's an interesting phrase in there as well in the discussion. I watched the whole thing earlier, but it says you need to have no fear about process change. Well, that does not exist in reality. If you operate with a profit margin of 2-3%, I guess, on average, then you don't want to dive in and change your entire process, so that goes step by step.
You know, we need to do a better job as customers communicating to the technology companies of what are we really trying to solve, what are our real big problems, and not necessarily, hey, what are the features that we need.
As we talk to those customers, what we're hearing, and I'd like to hear from you as well, is how come you don't speak to each other? Which brings up the idea of interoperability. How would you answer why we don't speak to each other?
We do. Actually, Kris is kind of the fire starter there. The customer is saying, hey, guys, talk to each other. But I think most modern companies are talking to one another, and those that aren't, they don't get it.
The customers are really driving this a lot as well. They're really getting tired of point solutions and having to not only, you know, manage their projects across 10 different pieces of software, but you know, they also have to train people across 10 different pieces of software, and what they want is a single solution. Now, there's never going to be a product that does everything they ever want, so what we need to do as a community is come together, focusing again on the problems that they're trying to solve, and present them with a solution.
I think there's a willingness from all of us to have open APIs, application programming interfaces, but that doesn't solve it. You can open the doors,
yes.
But how do you know where to walk when the doors are open?
That's a great point.
And standards are needed to make that easier for us. If I'm calling an RFI with a certain set of attributes, then I'd like to send that over to Bluebeam without having to translate it.
Yeah. That data dictionary, that common language, you know, so much of what we've talked about is us being able to communicate as customers back and forth to the technology vendors and being able to kind of speak the same language, and we don't. So, but I think we're a lot closer than we actually realize we are, because you guys are dealing with a lot of owners, as I would call them, or a lot of customers, and we hate jobs when we have 10 owners making 10 different decisions,
right.
And you guys hate developing software when you have to have 25 different people telling you what to do. So we have the same frustrations, but we just don't necessarily always communicate them well. And what's interesting is that you said that, you know, we're looking for the one solution, and I don't know if that's necessarily true with all the customers, because I've come to realize, like, there's never going to be one solution that's going to do everything I want, right? So that's why I am a customer of every single one of you, because each one of you does something unique that is good.
The motivation is here, and the tools are catching up to be able to execute on the motivation, I think, that we've all had. And in concert with end users, I think it's an exciting future for all of us, really. So we don't have to do anything in isolation. We can really solve the solutions for the community collectively.
As much as we're friendly, we're frenemies in some ways, because there is that business case for competition. How do you discipline yourselves internally and in order to not fall to FOMO or fear of missing out? How do you discipline yourselves internally to know what to focus on and what to kind of leave?
It's a new paradigm for the software and tech industry to be able to invite those we saw as true competitors now to the table. So the more we can be honest and upfront and transparent with the process to all parties involved, I think that starts to break down the walls and helps us create those solutions collectively.
Mm-hmm. I think that all of us want to focus on our strengths, but we're often asked to do the contrary, because you have to include adjacent areas as well in order to make it a smooth experience for the customers.
Yeah, you do this great, but we'd love to see you do this.
Yes.
It's like,
yes,
they're almost forcing you into a place where you have to try to go into a place you know you're not good at.
Mm-hmm. I think we have to be honest with our capabilities. And we can't, like we've all said, we can't build it all. So in that point, we call in the right people for the job to create the solutions for the end user at the end of the day.
And Will, you're actually, out of everyone on this panel, you're the true technologist, meaning you didn't necessarily come from the AEC industry into technology. You've been in technology this whole time, and probably you're very much aware of FOMO and how do you help with Procore and their focus?
Well, I think first and foremost, you have to be really disciplined about what your company does, right? What's the value of your product, and what problems are you trying to solve first and foremost? And focus there. If you try to do it all, you're going to end up having a lot of solutions that don't really solve the problem, that weren't well thought out, and that don't make your customers happy, and you're going to lose. And then the other piece is, you know, yes, okay, so maybe they're a competitor, maybe they're a partner. You know, there's that kind of blurred line that we experience here as we try to work together. But I think at the end of the day, you're probably going to have a bigger chance of losing as a company if you don't work with the others in our industry, because at the end of the day, we're all trying to solve the same problem, and if you're the one that takes your ball and goes home and says, you know what, I'm not going to participate because they're my competitor and they're my competitor, then the customer doesn't win. And if the customer doesn't win, definitely the software vendor doesn't win.
And Doug, you kind of the newbie on the block here. You recently made some pretty hard decisions and changed course a little bit and streamlined the interface.
Yep.
And tell us a little bit about what caused you to make that decision.
Simplicity is everything. It's essential for the set of problems that we are trying to solve and for the types of people that we're trying to solve them for. It's really got to be a simple, very simple solution. So we simplified the application. We took away features. Kris yelled at us. Other people yelled at us.
But my users have given feedback that it's much nicer and much easier to use.
Yeah. So for us, and it kind of goes with what was being said earlier, which is if frenemies didn't exist, if platforms that handled the more traditional project management flows didn't exist, then my customers would be asking me to build them and demanding that we do, because they wouldn't have those solutions available to them, which means I'd fail at what I believe is the fundamental problem that Fieldlens exists to solve. I think the word discipline was used earlier. That's how I feel about this problem. You have to be incredibly disciplined. The best thing you can do as a software vendor in this space, just like the best thing a contractor can do in some scenarios, is say no. no, Mr. Owner, we can't do that, because if we do that, it's gonna screw up your schedule or your cost or your whatever. And if you can say no to people and you build that relationship with them, there's a lot of respect that kind of ensues, and you get a better product for that and you get happier customers.
The correlation between the software developer and the general contractor, there's a lot of parallels that can be drawn there. And much like we had after the 2008-2009 financial crisis, joint ventures were all the rage all of a sudden. You know, I saw trailer job sites banners with two names side by side I never thought I'd see side by side. And it was this great agitation or this great depression kind of idea that caused this integration or these joint ventures that showed, hey, we have better value together. It's the same I see very much for the technology company sitting up here. Another parallel is it's almost like a general contractor who takes an owner into a BIM cave and walks the owner through the BIM cave and says, hey, here's your building, here's how the sun's gonna track over that building, here's all your finishes, doesn't this look fantastic, let's go out to the job site, and the owner stands in front of a dirt hole in the ground. And they're like, where's my building? Mm-hmm. Well, first we have to dig a hole, then we have to put some rebar down, and then we pour concrete, and oh yeah, that takes, 30 to 32 days depending on the weather, and once that cures, then we can start building. Very much the same for technology companies is there is a process, there is...
Supply chain.
Yes, exactly. Very similar. So how do you see the similarities between our customers and ourselves as technologists? How do you see that similarity really helping us to solve some of these really complex challenges better together?
Well, it's interesting. Another parallel is that we share an industry certification. There's an industry certification out there called the PMP, which started really on the software and the technology side, but then it started to get adopted by the construction industry because we realized how kind of aligned, so then they started to market. So we're literally going through the same process of how to procure, how to price, how to schedule, how to build. And you were talking about schedules earlier of getting things done, and very similar to a construction project, you gotta have a schedule to get it done, otherwise it won't get done if it just keeps getting kicked down the road. Mm-hmm. So I think the sooner that we as contractors, subcontractors, construction industry folks start to realize that we really do speak the same language. It may be different words, it may be different acronyms, lean, agile, they're the same thing. Mm-hmm. We just need to get together and go, holy crap, we're talking the same language here. Let's just slow down a little bit and see if we can align and kind of make the road together.
You don't build a feature in reaction to a customer saying, I need that thing. You build a feature in reaction to, hey, Kris, like, what's the type of problem you're trying to solve here? And then 10 more conversation, what's the type of problem I'm trying to solve here? So the idea that Kris and I kicked around like a week ago was, imagine if before you bid a project on the construction side, you had a conversation with the owner about their goals for the building, right? As opposed to plans and specs. Because if we built to plans and specs that were provided to us by our customers, I'm sorry, but the apps would be terrible, right? And yet, the construction industry is constantly, well, that's what we do, right? We build buildings based on plan and spec.
When we talk to technologists and software companies and we talk about the future, we kind of talk about lofty, big goals. Each of you sitting here, though, are very actively involved in the development of the technology. So you're seeing very close up the challenges of pushing the technology forward and the roadmap and the, I'm sure for each of us, a very jam-packed roadmap. So what should our customers be looking for in the future from us as far as us speaking to each other or working together?
I think data structures are going to be the most important. So applications are how users will interact with those data structures. But it doesn't matter that much anymore because if we get our data structures to work together, then you can build any subset of functionality on top of that.
It's super important that we continue to involve the customer in these integrations. It used to be unheard of that you'd have two software vendors on the call with the same customer talking about how those two companies can work together to solve their problem, and I think we need to do more of that. We're seeing a lot of the platforms being opened up, open APIs, and I think that's a great start because it means we're all headed that direction, but the actual tangible things that we build and the solutions that we build, like you said, we have packed roadmaps, time is very important. We need to get together, everybody involved from the customer to the vendors, to all the different roles from the customer side and really truly understand the issues and then go out and build something that solves for it.
It's really quieting the noise of technology to a certain degree. I mean, I think we're all motivated for success in the end user, and the end user is to focus on what they do, not the technology itself. So if it's you're building the building, you're able to engineer your submittals, you're able to answer your RFI, much faster so you can keep on schedule and you can have a happy owner at the end of the day. We're now putting those parts and pieces together as an industry to really see that come to fruition. I think it's a really exciting time.
We're seeing customers build it themselves. And I think that construction companies, as they hire more and more young people coming out of school that have technology backgrounds, even if they're not full-time technologists, I think you'll be shocked to see what will be hacked together at these construction companies between the different softwares that are up here and the many others that are up there. I absolutely think we're going to see it. We are seeing it.
Yeah, I love that point. If we can enable our customers and other vendors to do the work themselves, you'd be surprised. They come. They you know, small startups will come and start building on your platform. Your customers will come and start building on your platform. And you know, sometimes you'll come across that that one particular piece of work they're doing where you say, why aren't we doing that? but in general, I think it's pretty encouraging that the industry is going that direction. And I'd say, you know, part of it too is that, you know, the construction industry in general has been kind of underserved from a technology standpoint over the past decade. And now that it's really starting to get an influx of new technology and new companies popping up, the customers are starting to realize that, hey, there's options out there. We're really in control, which should be the case and has been the case in many other industries. And now I think they're starting to understand that. And it's now up to us to really, you know, bring that to truth and start building stuff that actually solves their problems.
Well, the problem is we underpay. We don't pay enough. We don't spend enough money on the technology.
You heard it here.
Yeah. Listen, I'm that guy. I said it. Let me turn the tables and just ask one question. You know, Sasha kind of asked, what do you need from the customer? Yeah, or what can you guys do? But let me ask, what more can you get? What more can we give you? You know, you said, you know, we're starting to do some of the developing our own. And I've hacked together some things and I can get it to work like one time, one item at a time. But that's not a solution. But I'd hope that I take that to one of you guys. I go, here's the proof of concept that I want. Make that so that somebody won't laugh at the code and go from there. But like, what more can we give you in a more meaningful way?
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that we experience quite often is just the industry's fear of trying something new. Don't be afraid to try something new. Like, it's okay, give it a try. If it doesn't work for you, try something different and you'll figure out what the right solution is for you. That will help us because hopefully through that process, you'll give us feedback.
Keep bringing it to the table, keep listening. There is a constant, like, continuous improvement with this process. So if we abandon it, we're all gonna lose. So the more we stay engaged both ways, we're gonna come up with a solution.
It's funny you say that because I was in a meeting this morning and somebody made a point to bring up that a feature that I'd asked for like a year and a half ago was coming out in a new release. You have to stick with it. You can't just walk away after a short period of time and go, well, they don't listen.
We are more alike than we are dissimilar. Mm-hmm. And that relationship you build with an owner, you hope has longevity to it, so you get more projects and you build that long-term relationship. So over time, you learn to know each other and your businesses very well, and you know exactly what to expect from that. And there's a certain amount of trust that comes with a really good partnership.
Exciting times.
Yeah. Absolutely. So thank you so much. Appreciate
it very
much.
Thank you.
Let's go build some integrations, huh?
By the end of our conversation, it struck me that we had come full circle. The tech industry needs the feedback from the field just as much as the field needs specialized solutions from the tech industry. Only through dialogue between the field and technologists can the evolving challenges of the industry truly be met.